Hello everybody, this is the video upload that we are doing in replacement for the show on the 28th, Practical Knowledge for the Awakening. This is the third part in our series on discussing truth, and we're going to get into natural law, which are some of the foundations of truth, basically the accumulated knowledge that has been passed down throughout the ages. I have to refer to images and slides, or we have to refer to images and slides, but we just got all the images here. And let me introduce Julian, my partner in crime here.
Hello. And you can also find all the slides on our blog at sitshow.blogspot.com. That's sitshow.blogspot.com.
Yes, I'm also in the video description. I am going to include a link to the previous shows, and inshallah, at some point, God willing, I am going to put a tab on the website for the archive show, so you can go back and listen. Now, this is the third part in the series, and we're creating a tapestry of information here. So there is some continuity to what these shows have. The first two shows we're discussing how we discover truth, what a truth actually is, the scientific method, so to speak, of testing a truth or a premise and an idea. And now we're going to get into some of the actual hard foundations of truth, or the natural law concepts that, as I was mentioning earlier, are a lot of the accumulation of knowledge that has been passed down for a long time, generation upon generation. And so, before we do that, we're going to go over our first slide here. So we're on slide number one, Practical Knowledge for the Awakening. So we're just going to kind of discuss the show and who we are. We are not gurus or authorities on truth, but we have acquired knowledge to share. So even though we're going to discuss these ideas with a fair amount of conclusiveness, we don't claim to have absolute certainty on what these concepts are. We have achieved a level of understanding, and we're beginning to discuss that. But as always, our understanding is dynamic, and it's constantly growing and expanding, especially when we discuss these ideas with others. We discuss ideas as a premise, a coded zip file or box of potential knowledge. So a premise, we covered this last week, I'll just briefly mention this. A premise is like a supposition or an offer, an idea. So if somebody makes a statement like, it's cloudy outside. That's a premise. It's an idea. It's like a coded piece of understanding that you can unlock, dissect, and then test and to see if it's actually real knowledge or not. So that's what we're doing here today. Together, we determine an idea's veracity, its truthfulness. Now, the word veracity means how true something is. And that process of determining veracity is really enhanced when we work with others and have an open discussion. True seeking is the creative action for all awakening. So, just generally speaking, when we seek to know the truth, when we actually open ourselves up to try to understand the objects or experiences that we're going through, we really begin to awaken our consciousness or expand our consciousness. So that's kind of what our intention is here. So, what is natural law? That's what we're going to be covering today. Now, for those who have come to know what natural law is, this may be a review, but if you've never heard the term natural law before, it's basically divine law, spiritual law, physical laws, like in physics or science, and they all describe how the universe works. And essentially refer to the same truth. So even though physics or the study of chemistry may not necessarily relate to karma or honor and sovereignty and those kind of things, freedom, there are all of these things are really just different sides of the same coin. We mentioned this earlier last week, that the truth is singular, meaning there's really only one, the truth, or the truth is one. But we have, because we have a point of view, a perspective, we have multiple different ways we can view the truth. And when it comes to natural law in particular, natural law is an incredibly general truth. The other thing we mentioned last week about truths is that they have an applicable context. So depending on what the premise is, okay, it's going to apply to a certain context. It's going to enshroud or encapsulate a certain description of things. And the bigger you make the truth, the less you can pin it down to one thing. So, for example, if we talk about the truth that the earth is round, that is a truth, part of the truth, and it encapsulates a certain context, the earth. We're talking about a planet here. We're talking about a shape, okay? So we're describing something very specific, all right? But when we get into big truths, okay, that encompass a lot of things, now it becomes, the truth becomes less tangible, and there's less of a physical representation of it in our experience that we can definitely point our finger to. So as a result, we're going to be able to tackle a lot of these ideas by putting them in different contexts and comparing them to one each other, corresponding them to each other. So it is law. It's physical, mental, and spiritual. So the natural law applies to not only the physical realm, so the 3D world in the New Age parlance, or the world of material things, but it also applies to the mental realm, the realm of ideas, which are non-material things. And then we're also getting into the idea of spirit, so that it also applies to the spiritual laws, the essence of things. And they're self-evident, meaning that as long as you search for them, you can know them. So an old adage I love to remind myself of, or I love to say, is that, you know, when the student is ready, the teacher will come. And it doesn't necessarily mean that I think of myself as a teacher, but what I'm getting at here is that when we're really willing to find out, when we're really searching for the truth, then it'll be there for you. It's waiting for you. It's almost like the universe is begging you to understand and know yourself and yourself in relation to it, all things. So these laws that we're talking about, some of these things, some truths are so obvious that it just escapes our perception. So this has been known by many names. Natural law is the term that we refer to it as because it's been referenced in a lot of other circles in that way. So I think it's a good term, but there are many ways to describe a term. It's been described as Hermetic philosophy, which are the greater and lesser arcana. Now, the greater arcana is natural law as it applies to the macrocosm. So we're talking about, you know, the universe or space or society or the planet, okay? But the lesser arcana, that is referring to our inner world, our inner beingness, okay? So we're really talking about ancient psychology. Natural law is... it's been around for a long, long time. The Hermetic philosophy in particular comes from Hermes. And if I remember my timing correctly, I believe that that character was supposedly existed in myth around before 4000 BC. And there's some legends and myths and stories that describe who Hermes was, which we're not going to get into. But the point is that this information, this knowledge, has been around for a very long time, and it's nothing new. As a matter of fact, considering what were the context of truth, like we talked about last week, Julian, you know, if a truth is a reflection of the truth, you know, when you found something that is actually true, well, it doesn't mean that you've created some new truth that didn't exist before. The truth was already there, existed in the moment now, and will continue to exist in the future. So what we've really done when we come to understand and know the truth is we're actually just recreating it, we're reflecting it, and representing it within ourselves consciously. So we're expanding our knowledge base. So these natural law is something that has been deeply occulted, which simply means hidden. The term occult has become synonymous with a lot of negative and bad things. We're from the United States, and there is a big awakening, I guess you could say Bible movement or Christianity movement, where there's a lot of people who are realizing that there's something not right on the planet, and that some people on the earth are doing some nasty things, and they're kind of filtering that through the Christian doctrines and whatnot, and the Bible in particular. And they usually refer to the bad things as the occult, and they kind of just lump everything that is bad into this general term called the occult. That's not actually what the occult is, though. All the occult means, the actual word occult, by the way, Mark Passier has amazing explanations on what this is, so he really dials into what the occult is. But generally speaking, I won't get into the etymology for fear of not getting it exactly correct, but it basically comes from the term oculus, and which is an eye or a lens. And when things are occulted, they're hidden. They're just simply hidden from view. Now, this leads right into the next point, which is it can be used to create harmony within and without. It is the basis for true freedom and personal sovereignty. So, briefly, why are these truths, why is this knowledge about really everything? I mean, if anybody, I'm a pretty science-y kind of guy, and I've been studying science a lot in my life. I went to school for physics for a few years, and I've heard of unified field theories and theories of everything and string theory, and you know, the science is trying to develop a complete and holistic understanding of everything. Well, wouldn't it be crazy to find out that somebody already did that a long time ago? And what's even crazier is this knowledge, this science, this understanding helps us. You know, just to use the whole science analogy again, you know, when discoveries in science are made, you know, when the man who discovered electricity it was, it expanded the knowledge in the society. Scientific knowledge is just an accumulation of facts, which are just representations of the truth in a particular accepted way. Now, the representation may not accurately reflect the truth, but the point is here is that when you do have an accurate reflection of the truth, when science has accurately decoded something and understood something, and we have a theory that actually empowers us, what happens? We get all sorts of new amazing things. I mean, look at the past 50 years. We've got a tremendous explosion of technology. I'm recording this radio show or this YouTube video on a laptop computer right now, which is the product of accumulated knowledge. So, and we mentioned this extensively in the previous two shows, but the amount of positive knowledge or accurate knowledge that you have accumulated empowers you to create things in your reality. More importantly, it empowers you with effective methods of realizing your desires. So, you know, if you have a desire to be skinny and muscular or athletic, but all you do every day is sit around and eat bonbons, then the methods that you're using to achieve your desires aren't really going to get you there. And maybe you've got some bad beliefs and bad knowledge that are blocking you from manifesting your desires that you want. So, one thing that I also suggested here is the basis for true freedom and personal sovereignty. Now, we're going to go through the seven principles of natural law, and I didn't go into the free will aspect completely in relation to how that applies to sovereignty. I actually want to do this in another presentation, but generally speaking, I'm going to hint at this and referring to this image on the right here. These laws describe how real freedom works and why real knowledge and real importance on having intrinsic knowledge, you understanding why something works so that you can do it for yourself, is the key to true freedom. It isn't described explicitly in the seven principles, but it's when we get into what knowledge is, what positive knowledge is versus negative knowledge, which again we did last week. I strongly suggest you look into that show if you're interested in that. We're talking about the ability to have skills. You know, so if you want to do something, if you want to play the guitar, if you want to become an auto mechanic, if you want to become a chef, yes, you could just follow the recipe, okay? And that'll get you, and that may get you the results, but that's extrinsic knowledge. You don't really understand why you're adding 2 tablespoons of salt and 3 tablespoons of baking soda, but you're just following the recipe, okay? Now you're dependent on whoever made the recipe. So if the guy who made the recipe didn't make the recipe right, what's going to happen? You're not going to get your desired results. But more importantly, what I'm kind of alluding to here is that you're going to be dependent on this other person's truth, their knowledge. And literally, because you are following their recipe, you're under their control. You could even say that you're under mind control because you receive the recipe and you begin to act in a way that the recipe dictates. Because you aren't using your own powers of discernment and knowledge to try to figure out, well, why this is the case and maybe adjust potential problems as you encounter them. You're just following the programming of somebody else. So what we're getting into here, what we're suggesting, is that this knowledge of how the universe actually works, gives you skills. It gives you the ability to create what you want, which is freedom. When you can direct yourself without dependency on somebody else, you are free from that other person, and now you're following your own inner guidance. And you're following the rules of nature. You're not following the instructions of man. Okay? So when we talk about positive knowledge and negative knowledge, when we talk about intrinsic knowledge versus extrinsic knowledge, we're talking about how you build up your own internal understanding of the reality that we're actually in and giving yourself skills so that you're not dependent on somebody else. And this is what creates true freedom. This is the basis of personal sovereignty. And this idea, this concept has been discussed throughout history, and especially during the time of the American Revolution. And I'll direct your attention to the image of Samuel Adams here, which Julian did a great job on this image, by the way. and it's a meme on natural law, and it reads, "The natural liberty of man is to be free from any superior power on earth, and not to be under the will or legislative authority of man, but only to have the law of nature for his rule." So basically what Samuel is talking about here, he's talking about true freedom. And what he describes, okay, but let's use this as an example. He's putting forth a premise, okay? He's saying that he's offering up an idea. Now let's kind of dissect this a little bit. The natural liberty of man, so natural liberty meaning that it's inherent, the freedom of man. Liberty means freedom. So man is already free, naturally. And to be free from any superior power on earth. So basically, we have the ability in our nature to be free from any superior, quote-unquote, power on earth. And not to be under the will or legislative authority of man. Well, just like I was talking about earlier with the recipe and being a chef, if you're just following the recipe of somebody else who did the chef, then you're following the will of somebody else, because their will is that you make it this way. If you want to make a cherry pie, you have to add all these ingredients. You didn't develop this recipe yourself by having a deep intrinsic knowledge of the ingredients, how they work, how cooking and chemistry works, how to apply heat, etc. You followed the legislative, legis, which means to write, authority, author, okay, of man. So basically we're talking about writing, creating an instruction list, an extrinsic knowledge basis, okay? And then it goes on to say, only to have the law of nature for his rule. Okay, so what he's kind of suggesting here, and this is what I get out of this, is that he's talking about anarchy. Now that word anarchy has been kind of linked to chaos and people who are willing to do anything they want to kind of get their way, and that's not what we're talking about here. The anarchists that we come to know in our modern times are not true anarchists. They're more nihilists. They believe in nothing. They don't believe in rules. They don't believe in natural law. They believe in doing whatever the hell they want. And if they gotta kill somebody, if they gotta steal from somebody, if they gotta destroy something to get what their desires are, then they're perfectly willing to do that. And there's nothing wrong with that. Well, that's not true anarchy. Okay? Anarchy is a word that comes from arch or archon, which means ruler. So an is antithesis, or anti, so it's against rulers, okay? It does not mean against rules. That's the key, and that's what Samuel is describing here. He's saying that we are naturally born free, and we don't have to follow any superior power on earth, and we don't have to listen to the rules and mandates that have been created at the whim of man. That's what legislation is, you know. For example, in the United States, in Florida, it's illegal to have marijuana on your person. But I could go to Colorado, and it's perfectly legal. So these are rules, these are policies that somebody created, somebody decided that we should have these things. And really, they're only enforced by agreement, meaning that they're enforced because you agree by your very actions to follow the rules that they write down, the offer or the suggestion. So really, all authority on earth, anything that comes down from man, so if you think about the rules of, what's the example he was talking about, like McDonald's, I think, right?
Or any corporation that has like a employee handbook.
Right.
Anything.
So like if, we used to work in a call center, for example. So we had to be at work at 9 o'clock, and we had to, you know, there's all these rules that we have to follow.
You have to wear a certain set of clothes, you have to have security clearance, you have to say certain phrases, you have to act a certain way.
Exactly. So where did these rules come from? Were these rules in nature? Or are they created by somebody's will? And when we're talking about creation of somebody's will, it's an offer, a suggestion. Even if somebody's standing in front of you with a baseball bat or a loaded weapon and telling you to do something, it's still just a suggestion. They have to force you to do something because in reality they can't really force you to do something. They threaten you with violence to coerce you into doing something. Okay? Now, granted, your options may be limited. If somebody's holding a gun to you and says, if you don't give me all your money, I'm going to kill you, and you say, go to hell, I'm not giving you any money, and he shoots you, well, that's the ramifications of what happened. But you still have a choice. That's the point. And if you choose to give him all your money, you may want to think of yourself as being the victim, and in a way you certainly are, okay? Because the use of violence meaning to violate somebody's free will, versus force, which is just a direction of will, two different things here. You may think of yourself as being a total victim, and I'm not saying you're not a partial victim in that sense, but as far as having absolutely no choice at all, I didn't have any choice, I had to give him my money, that's not actually true. You did have a choice. And my point is here is that any authority on earth, especially as it comes down from man, is only ever an agreement, and it will never be anything else but an agreement. So the laws that we have on earth, especially legislative statutes, titles, you know, codes, council codes, all these things, they're all just agreements. And specifically, they're tacitus agreements, meaning it's implied. So if you're at a stoplight, if you pull up to a stoplight and the light is red, Okay? If you stop, it means by your actions, because there's something telling you to stop, okay? By your actions of recognizing the fact that it's telling you to stop and you choosing to stop, you are in agreement, okay? It's implied versus explicit, meaning somebody coming up to you and saying, "Sir, I want you to stop. Do you agree? Are there any other things that we need to talk about so we have a clear understanding so you can choose to do this action?" That's an explicit agreement, okay? So, the natural liberty of man is born free. Okay, it's natural meaning that it exists within us, and we don't have to follow any superior power on earth, because in reality there is no superior power on earth unless we, through our own ignorance, choose not to educate ourselves. Okay, the goal really is to have nature be our rule. Okay, so an anarchist is something that, or someone who realizes that all authority is really illusory. There's really no such thing as authority. It's a magic trick, okay? They may use coercion, they may use force, they may threaten you with violence, but that in and of itself proves my point, because if they didn't have to use that, they'd be able to wave their hand like a magic wand and do whatever they want, okay? But for the rule of nature, or the rules of nature, to be their guide, so an anarchist doesn't believe in rulers, but they do believe in rules. And more specifically, an enlightened anarchist, I'll even throw that extra adjective on there, is somebody who acknowledges natural law, understands it, seeks to understand it in greater degrees, and acts it out in their reality. They try to honor it. Okay? So a true enlightened anarchist is somebody who's going to recognize the sovereignty and free will of another being, and will act honorably with them. I'm not going to get too deep into it, but what we're talking about here is honor and morality. And there's honor in relation to contracts and agreements is really an incredibly empowering series of concepts that allows us to understand what real freedom is and how we can actually live it in our reality. I know when Julian and I get into discussions about freedom and anarchy and not having any rulers or authorities, a lot of the reactions we get from people is, well, if there's no authority, then it's just going to be chaos, because people usually assume that without an authority, there will be no rules. But that's not actually the case. I mean, with honor and honoring natural law and honoring agreements, acting transparently, acting with integrity and recognition of everybody's free will choice, and the necessity to share knowledge and empower other people, we are literally given the keys to creating an enlightened society, a utopia where there are no rulers. It's just a conglomeration of beings who recognize their true relationship to reality and act in honor with natural law, having the rule of nature be their guide versus the dictates of man. All right, so let's get into some of the properties of natural law. So what are the qualities? What are we talking about when we talk about natural law? Well, natural law is perpetual, immutable, and self-administrating. So perpetual means it keeps going. As we mentioned in the previous show about the truth existed before, it exists now, and will continue to exist in the future. Same thing with a truth. If you've understood a part of the truth, it was true before, it's going to be true now, and will be true in the future, depending on whatever context it applies to. It may be dynamic, it may change, in the sense that the way it is actually understood, the principle, may change if the context changes, but a truth usually harmonizes with the truth, or it does harmonize with the truth. Now, it's immutable, meaning it can't be broken. So you may have the perception that it's being broken. So for example, we talk about gravity. That's one of the physical laws. So, you know, you throw a rock off a cliff, 99.99999% of the time that rock is going to hit the ground at the same rate of speed, etc. Now, the few times it may not, okay, maybe you're in the Bermuda Triangle, maybe you're doing some anti-gravity work, or something like that. It may seem like the rule or the law is being broken, but that's not actually the case. It's just being used in a different way. And that's something that we're going to get into here later as we discuss the seven aspects or the principles. And it's self-administrating. Self-administrating means, or administering means, there's not any person, there's not a human being who has to go and make sure that it gets done. If you throw a rock off a cliff, it's going to hit, it's like a program. It's like a computer program. You put in information, you put in a code, and a result gets spit out. Same thing with natural law. It's already working in this beautiful harmony. There's no other personal force, as far as human is concerned, that has to come in and make sure it keeps happening. Now, the law, or natural law, is one, but can be understood as seven principles. So we're going to get into these seven principles. And these seven principles are really just perspectives or points of views on the law, or the one law of natural law, or the truth. So we can understand these in different perspectives, and the principles are going to describe that, but as far as are they unified, is one exclusive to another? We mentioned the term mutually exclusive last week. Where something is mutually exclusive, it means that it relates only in and of itself, but as soon as you compare it to something else, there is no correlation. Okay, that's not what the seven principles are. They're perfectly harmonized with each other. It's like seven sides of the same coin. So, requires no government, policemen, courts, or jails for enforcement. Just like I was talking about earlier, natural law doesn't need to be enforced by anybody. It already enforces itself. So, you know, you go to cook on the stove, and you're using a cast iron skillet with no protective handle, and you go to grab that handle, and it's really hot without an oven mitt. What's going to happen? Your hand's going to get burnt. Nobody had to come in and wave their hand over your hand, or use a magic wand, or issue a court order to make sure that you felt the pain that you were supposed to feel in relation to your mistake. You're going to feel it immediately. And it's built into the reality, so to speak. Okay? It is no respecter of persons, religions, governments, institution, race, or ethnic background. Now, when we say no respecter, it means it doesn't care what your religion is, it doesn't care what your beliefs are, it doesn't care what government you're a part of, what institution you're in, whether you're Catholic or Protestant or Buddhist, it doesn't care if you're white or black, it doesn't care if you're Hispanic, it doesn't care about any of those things. All it cares about is what was caused, what did you do, what was your action, and what is the result. And the result is directly correlated to the cause. All are subjects to the law without regard for special treatment or favoritism. So one example Mark Passio uses in his natural law seminar, which I strongly suggest everybody watch. It's a very in-depth presentation. I think it's like 9 hours or something like that. You can find that on YouTube. But one example that Mark gives is that, you know, you can imagine a family, they're eating a picnic with their little girl who's like 1 or 2 years old, and they're on the side of a like cliff overlooking a beautiful lake, for example. And they're like 20 feet away from the cliff, and the parents are so enraptured in, you know, how amazing the day is that they don't notice that the baby, their little girl, has walked towards the cliff and accidentally slips and falls off the cliff. Now, natural law doesn't care how old the little girl is. It doesn't care whether or not the little girl has acknowledged the fact that gravity exists, okay? It's going to give the result that the actions... that whatever action was taken. So if the little girl goes and walks towards the cliff and falls off the cliff, well, she's going to fall and she's going to hit the ground and maybe even may die or be horribly injured. You know, so the point I'm getting at here is that the law isn't really, this law isn't interested in your desires. It doesn't care about you in the sense that it's not going to bend itself to meet your needs. Matter of fact, I would argue that the natural law, or karma, as we're going to get into in a moment, is in place to give you those experiences so that you can change yourself and look within. You know, when we talk about dynamic systems and things that change versus things that don't change, if natural law doesn't change, it hasn't changed, it isn't changing now, and it never will change, then what is really the thing that is changing? What is the variable here? And the variable is us. We get to change. And we get to understand and know and develop knowledge about these principles, about reality, so that we can come to know it better. And I'll even say that the creator, or first source, or spirit, or whatever name you want to give it, okay, has put these codes in place, and it is a very loving gesture to not change the rules. Because if he changed the rules, if she changed the rules, every time somebody felt like they were getting a bum rap, well, then wouldn't they not learn? Like, if you go to grab that really hot skillet on the stove, and even though it's hot, you don't burn yourself, well, what's going to happen? You're never going to learn to put an oven mitt on so you don't burn yourself. So what good are you really doing, or what good would come about by trying to shield somebody from reality? Yeah. So even though it seems kind of harsh, like, oh, well, natural law doesn't care about you, that's a really harsh thing to say, Justin. You know, if you look at it from a really grand kind of soul growth perspective, it's really like one of the most incredibly empowering, loving things that we're experiencing. The fact that we're in a reality, that we have will, we have the choice, as Samuel was talking about earlier. We're giving these natural freedoms, natural freedom meaning free will in this case, to actually choose to understand the ramifications of our actions. Okay? And when we do this, we can enrich our knowledge base, we can come to understand reality more accurately, and then we can manifest our desires more profoundly, more succinctly. So turning our attention to this image, which, by the way, is from Mark Passio's Natural Law presentation. It's a fantastic image.
What's the name of the presentation again?
I believe it's Natural Law, the Real Law of Attraction, Mark Passio. We posted it on our blog. I've got it embedded in a whole bunch of different posts. You can just search for Natural Law and Stillness in the Storm in Google, and it'll pop right up. And all the videos are in there. Or you can go to YouTube and search for Natural Law with Mark Passio. Search for that, and it should pop right up. And his website, by the way, is whatonearthishappening.com. Okay, so let's review some of the points in this image here. We have the law of cause and effect. So effect invariably follows cause. For every action, there exists an equal and opposite reaction. So, me having a science background, when I look at this, I'm thinking about a lot of the physical laws that are described in physics. So, even though natural law encompasses way more than just the material reality, it's already kind of highlighting a really major point that when you've got even a truth, which is a part of the truth, it's going to harmonize with the whole truth. So we may want to call it the law of thermodynamics. We may want to call it, electromagnetism, electromagnetic laws, something like that. But these little slices of truth, okay, are going to be referring or correspond to the whole truth. The law of attraction. The energy you emit is the energy you attract. Energy flows where attention goes. As you think, feel, and act, so shall you be.
Right.
So this one has, it's been misinterpreted in a lot of the New Age communities. Mark, if anybody's familiar with Mark Passio's work, you know he's very vocal and has no problem getting There's no problem getting in your face and kind of being aggressive and saying things with conviction. And he has a several presentations on what he calls New Age bullshit. And this particular, the law of attraction, especially the first line, the energy you emit is the energy you attract, has been greatly misunderstood by many people. Now, that is true, but what the conclusion a lot of people draw is that, well, as long as I don't focus my attention on something I judge as negative, then it doesn't exist, or it'll go away on its own. Or more to the point, I won't be recreating it in my reality, and I won't be an active participant in maintaining that. So basically, the premise here is that if you ignore something, you will be doing something, the act of ignoring something is going to somehow deconstruct the negative thing that you've judged. But if we really, if we look, let's take that premise and let's analyze it for a minute. How many times in your life has ignoring something actually made it go away? And I would argue that ignoring something almost never makes it go away. Especially when we're talking about things that we deem as negative. You know, if we're talking about, to use the example earlier, you burn your hand. Okay, you had a nasty experience of burning your hand. That's something you judge as negative. If you try to ignore the experience, you try to forget about it, is that going to make what happened or what caused it go away? Well, no, of course not. The whole point, the reason you burned your hand is because you didn't grab the oven mitt. Your process or your method for manifesting the action or the desire, the implied goal of picking up the skillet, was faulty. It was based on false knowledge, the false knowledge that you could actually pick something up that's hot without burning your hand. So within that quote-unquote negative experience are the keys to your salvation. There, inside that negative experience is the thing that you can learn from through discernment and analysis and contemplation to then direct your energy in a proper way, in a way that actually does manifest your desire. So to re-encapsulate my point here about the bogus law of attraction, the bogus law of attraction is that if you ignore something, you ignore the negative, if you don't focus on the negative, it'll just go away and you won't experience it anymore. That is definitely bullshit. The real law of attraction is the energy you emit is the energy you attract. So if you emit energy of ignorance or a geometry or consciousness of ignorance, then that's what you're going to get. You're going to get missteps. You're going to get unconsciousness. You know, you can imagine if you're running down the street and you're staring straight up at the sky, you can't even see what's down in front of your feet. You're like ignoring the floor, okay? You're in this consciousness of ignorance. What are you going to attract with that experience? Well, as soon as something comes up that you can't see, like a big dip in the road or a pothole, you're going to hit the pothole and you're probably going to fall flat on your face. So within this correct definition of the law of attraction, the energy of ignorance is going to get you more malady, more chaos. So the energy of acknowledgement, the energy of consciousness, of truth, is going to get you positive things. It's going to get you, allow you to manifest what you really want. Energy flows where attention goes, okay? So to use an empowering description, I'll try to get away from the whole bogus version, just talk about the real version. Where the law of attraction is what you put your attention on, okay? Attention, focus is going to naturally create, okay, an awareness of things. We covered this extensively last week. You know, if you walk into a room and you are blindfolded, your attention's not on the room. Okay, if you take the blindfold off and you see that there are objects on the table, there's a glass of water, there's a knife, there's some cheese, there's some crackers. Well, all of these objects, okay, they can relate to each other, they correspond to each other. And maybe if you're feeling hungry in your body, which is another object, well, now the correspondence or the relationship that is acknowledged within you because you've put your attention on it, you've recreated it in your mind via images, okay? It creates the potential for action. That's what happens in our reality. Again, we covered this extensively last week. When you come to give meaning to the objects in your experience is pretty much neutral. from your body's perspective, it's just like a computer. It's ones and zeros. Okay? And then with your mind, you take those ones and zeros and you start to make sense and represent them in your reality. Okay? Or in your mind. So now, when you're hearing my voice, when you're staring at this image on the computer, okay, it's literally something that's inside your mind. The thing that you're looking at, the thing that you're actually receiving as far as your body's concerned, is neutral. It doesn't have any meaning. But when you expose yourself to it through your attention naturally draws in the data points, and then your mind is going to try to start to make sense of it, okay? And when it starts to make sense of it, there's going to be potential actions that come up. You know, if you're hungry and you walk into the room, like I was mentioning earlier, and you see the cheese and the crackers on the table, well, now you've got a potential desire to work through. You can use this knowledge that you've acquired accurately, more to the point, and you can say, well, I can take some cheese and I can put it on this cracker and I can eat it and it'll make me not hungry anymore. Okay? So again, you've accurately represented reality because you put your attention on something. The energy flows where attention goes, all right? As you think, so you feel, so you act. So you shall be. So what this is referring to here is kind of a causality or a chain of events. And we're going to be getting into this deeply here in the next few slides. But basically what we're talking about here is because everything in you that you experience subjectively, your personal experience, is actually a reflection of your sense data as it has been deciphered and decoded based off your knowledge base, which is how you choose to understand and give meaning to the sense data you're receiving. Okay? If what you're thinking or how you've envisioned the reality actually reflects it, then you'll have a feeling or the energy in motion, okay, compelling the desire, the intention, to then act on something, okay? And if everything is in harmony because it's reflecting accurately, then you will be creating what you want. You'll be manifesting the desires you want, okay? This is what the law of attraction is talking about. So what the law of attraction is really hinting at is that if you have positive knowledge, if you've acquired real knowledge, okay, then when you are exposed to the things in your reality that represent that knowledge, like food, in the example I was giving earlier, then you have a feeling, a desire, a charge, which will then allow you to act on something. And if those are in harmony, then you get what you want. If you mistake something, like if you come into the room and you take your blindfold off and now on the table there's a bunch of mothballs and you accidentally mistake the mothball for a bonbon or something, well, you're going to have a problem when you go to eat it, right? You may have a feeling like, oh, I want to eat that, but as soon as you eat it, what's the other thing that's going to happen? You're going to have a nasty experience, aren't you? So, again, it reinforces the whole chain of events here. If you represent your reality accurately with positive knowledge, when you are exposed to the symbols of that knowledge in reality, you'll be created an emotional charge which will impel you or compel you to act. Karma, or moral law. You reap what you sow. So basically what this is talking about, as we hinted back at earlier, is that whatever the modus or the amount of accuracy you've acquired with in relation to your experience is going to create a charge for you want to do something, and then you're going to act on it. Now, the result of what you get, okay, karma and moral law, we're kind of talking about causality or cause and effect. Okay, so whatever the effect is, whatever actually manifests, is going to contain or be a reflection of the causes. Or more importantly, if you're trying to eat mothballs and you have a nasty experience, you could call that bad karma, and you're going to be given an experience which is potentially going to purify your knowledge base or give you the tools to then create an experience that you do want. Next time you see the mothballs on the table, you're going to say, oh, those aren't bonbons. Those are mothballs. So I'm not going to eat that. I'm going to eat the cheese and crackers that's right next to it. Excuse me, everybody. I've got a slight cold here. Then we have, finally, the golden rule. Do unto others as you would have done to yourself. So essentially what we're talking about here is, again, like we hinted at earlier, the honor and integrity. If you don't want somebody to beat you over the head, then don't beat somebody else over the head, especially if you're angry about the football match you just watched or whatever it is that happens to be getting you upset. And what this is kind of suggesting is that our goals and our desires do have an effect on others, and we should really consider that when we go to do something. My action is going to have a consequence that is going to affect somebody else? And if the answer is yes, well, what is your choice? I mean, you could say nothing and just let whatever happens, happens. Or you could take it upon yourself to make a statement and act transparently. Transparency is an idea that's kind of been gaining popularity for the past couple years. And it came about in relation to analyzing contracts. And Julian and I have researched this extensively. And as I mentioned earlier, I think it's that knowledge of how to act honorably in a contractual sense is what allows a society to be free from rulers and to honor rules or honor natural law. All right, the seven principles. So now we're going to get into the seven principles. So the seven principles are mentalism, correspondence, vibration, polarity, rhythm, causality, and gender. And we're going to dial into them pretty extensively here, but before we move on to that, a few things. Firstly, I chose colors, the colors that you see here, for a very specific reason. They're going to relate to things symbolically as we move on through the slides. So I've made words in the slides relate to certain principles as they're described. Okay, but more to the point, if you look to the right, you notice how the laws are kind of described in terms of colors here. And that mentalism, correspondence, and vibration are kind of on the outer fringe. But then when correspondence, the color yellow, and vibration come together, we get something else. We get this new color, orange, which makes rhythm. Okay? Or when we have the color blue, which is mentalism, comes in contact with vibration, we have the creation of a new color, which is polarity. Okay? So basically what is being suggested here is multiple, but that the seven principles are seven perspectives or modalities or aspects of the single law, the one law, and they're all unified. You can't divorce one from the other. You know, mentalism is going to have all the other seven laws working in harmony with it, just like correspondence and vibration and polarity. Now, that being said, there is like an overriding type of chain of events or causal chain of events. So in one of the last slides we have for this presentation, I'm going to go over that in detail, how there is like a pecking order, that mentalism follows correspondence, which follows vibration, et cetera, et cetera. Or I'm sorry, mentalism leads to correspondence, which leads to vibration, which leads to polarity, which leads to rhythm, which leads to causality, which leads to gender. So mentalism, what are we talking about mentalism? I haven't actually seen this TV show yet, but there's a show out there called The Mentalist, and I'm pretty sure it's about a guy who uses his mental powers to kind of discern and things. We have watched the show Elementary, mm-hmm. And it's the show about Sherlock Holmes, and he uses his powers of logic and reason to
deduce.
Exactly, deduce things. And experience. So when we're talking about mentalism, we're talking about mind here, or the powers of mind. Now, I just want to speak briefly before we go into the slide. One of the major New Age concepts that's floating around right now is that the mind is this bad thing, and it's holding us back, and it's just the ego, and that we need to get out of mind and into the heart. Okay. The mentalism or the mind that I'm describing in these this whole tapestry of information and shows that we're doing here is not that definition. The mind is essentially awareness. Okay, if you have the ability to be aware of something, then we're talking about a mindful phenomenon. All right, and emotion, feeling, or the heart space, you could say, is a property or is encapsulated within the mind. Okay, you can't divorce the mind from the heart. You can't divorce logic from love or intuition. They're both reflections of the same thing. They're intertwined with each other. Okay? It's just one end of the pole to the other. So I want to make sure that's very clear as we go through this. The mind concept that is out there about mind being bad or that you have to get out of mind, that's not what I'm talking about. That mind's more so referring to the static ego or some type of a fixed, implacable, absolute idea that you have that you refuse to let go of, and you need to open yourself up to allow it to change. That's something else.
The real mind is essential.
Exactly. Right. Okay, so each principle has a corresponding chakra that I've found that unifies with it, or goes with it, corresponds with it. So, firstly, the all is mind. So when we talk about the all, we talk, it's a term that I got out of the Hermetic philosophy. I feel like it's, and when we're talking about the all, we're talking about everything. The all, the totality of creation. And we could even extend this to include not just the creation, but all things and no things. Okay? The complete and total reality, all right, is the mind, or is mind. It's mental. It works in the mental arena. We can become aware of it, and it has awareness, the ability to be corresponded with things. Now, the chakra that relates to it is the crown chakra, which in many traditions has been synonymous with totality. So the crown chakra is usually used to refer to the total makeup of somebody's aura. In the Law of One series, which I've read, and is very good for understanding many things, but they describe how when they look to see where somebody's at in their spiritual progression, they look at the crown chakra. And when they do this, they see it's kind of like a reading or a report of the total aspect of where that being is at that time. Okay? So it is unity awareness, and it's the cause of mind. So the fact that you can be aware in a totality sense, okay, your total awareness of everything, this is the kind of the backbone for the mind, okay? So the fact that you have awareness, the fact that you can perceive objects, that you can perceive time, that you can perceive sensations and tastes and feelings and sights and sounds and all of this stuff together, all of this happens within the mindscape, the mental realm, okay? And it is the cause of mind in the sense that as objects correlate to each other, as there is a relative thing, so you take one object and you bring it next to another object, there's a relationship created depending on the context and whatnot. And we can come to know, we can be aware of what the relationship is. This is a mindful phenomenon, okay? Just like feeling, if you're having an emotional reaction, okay? You're married and your significant other is very upset and they don't feel too good about the fact that they lost their job, and you can kind of empathically feel that they're not happy right now, okay? It's like an intuition. Where you're becoming aware of the sensation, all right? And this awareness is within your mind, just like we were talking about earlier, your sense data, all sense data, not just the physical sensations of your body, but emotions, feeling, everything. All that is sense data. and it is reflected in the mind. Anything you're aware of is a mindal phenomenon, okay? Whether conscious or unconscious, subconscious. The creation of the universe, of things, and this again comes from the Hermetic tradition, but it's described in many other places, is a dream within the mind of the all, first source or spirit, the illusion discussed in so many works. The dreamer is dreaming. So, one law that of correspondence, which really helps us understand the mentalism law, is this idea of as above, so below, which we're going to get into earlier, but I wanted to just mention here briefly. So let's take this down to a human level. When you're dreaming, the things that are happening in your dream, for example, you may dream about a coworker, you may dream about a place, you may dream about objects, various things that you dream about, okay? And they're all happening within your mind. Now, these things in your dream, these objects, while you're in the dream, they're very real. If you have the experience of falling off a cliff, and I know I've had this happen in my dream. I had a dream one time where I was walking along a cliffside, and I got too far when I was looking over the edge, and I fell. And I remember distinctly the feeling of, you know, when your stomach kind of goes up in your chest and you feel that weightlessness feeling. I felt that in the dream. So for all intents and purposes, that was my reality. And that is a microcosmic example of what we're talking about here. You know, we as objects, okay, there's a correspondence here. It's a fractal. So in our dream, the objects are created within our mind. But then when we expand to include the whole of reality, the whole of reality is a dream or a mindal process of the creator or the all, okay? And this is where this idea of illusion comes from, okay? This is another term that has been thrown around a lot in the New Age works that I think is greatly misunderstood. It's illusory, meaning that in relation to the primal reality, the reality of the Creator, which refer to the second part of our series here, where we talk about the truth, and we talked about how the truth is one, it's singular and eternal. And the primal aspect of the reality, primal meaning first, okay, is beyond time and space, it is beyond distance, it is beyond things and objects, okay? So because of that, because in the beginning moment of all things, as has been described in many spiritual works, everything was totally unified, okay? And that's the actual true real reality. The perception or the experience of individuation, of the fact that you're an individual, the fact that an object has a unique property, the fact that you can be aware of things, all this are objects in the illusion. They're objects in the dream of the all, okay? And this is where this idea of the illusory reality comes from. Now, that doesn't mean, because we can acknowledge the fact that reality is illusory, or it doesn't, in relation to the primal reality, okay, it is an illusion, it doesn't mean that nothing matters. Okay, this is a really polarized conclusion that many people draw, especially in the awakening community. There's many philosophies out there that are erroneous or wrong in relation to this idea of the illusion. So when we acknowledge the concept of the illusion or the fact that our reality is illusory, it doesn't mean that nothing matters and that there's no point to life and you can do whatever the hell you want. What it means is that, just like a video game, okay, there are rules. There's certain processes. You know, if anybody's played a video game before, if you're in the video game and you want to get to the next level, well, you got to play the game. You have to follow the rules and you have to learn whatever skills that particular level is trying to teach you so that you can move on. And if you try to cheat, as most video gamers have done, I've done this myself, what happens? You never learn how to do the game properly. So when we talk about the illusory nature of reality, we can maintain this idea as kind of like a philosophical premise or a fundamental assumption about how what reality is. But other than that, we don't really need to hold on to it that much. More to the point, we can acknowledge the fact that reality is an illusion, but just like in the video game, we have to play by the rules of the game in order to move to the next level. And in that sense, to use that analogy of a video game, or a card game, or a sports game, you know, if you want to get better at playing basketball, and it requires dribbling the ball down the court, well, if you try to cheat and you don't dribble the ball down the court, you're not going to get better at it, and you won't become a better basketball player. And you may even be thrown out of the game. So it's the same idea here. There are certain rules. That the rules are, guess what, natural law. We're going over them right now. There are truths that everybody can come to know. And once you understand the rules and begin to act within them in your experience and reality, then you get to ascend, you get to become better and acquire skills, real knowledge, intrinsic knowledge that allows you to be freed from the determinism of experience, okay? And you actually get to work with the illusion, work with the rules in harmony to affect your desires, okay? Now, getting into what mentalism is for us, we reflect our environment, the sense data within our minds, creating the subjective experience. Just like I was mentioning earlier, objects in our experience, they're neutral. If you've never seen a computer before, okay, and you walk into a room and this is your first time seeing a computer, you're not going to know what to make of it because you have no internal meaning or understanding of what it is. You haven't created an image of it in your mind that corresponds to the sense data that you're receiving from your body and your perception. Okay, we create that through our free will choice to understand, to discern, to take a premise, an idea, to create a theory. Well, what is this thing? This thing, it's got a screen on it, there's images on it. It seems like people are doing things on it. Well, what's going on? So we start to observe and start to see how things correspond to each other. And then through understanding what those corresponding things are, we create a reflection of it within our minds. That gives us knowledge. We come to know reality by way of mental reflection, okay? A choice to recognize reality within. So recognize comes from recog or cognizant being aware. So we're aware of something, right? So we have the awareness, we're cognizant of it. But when we recognize it, when we recognize it, we're choosing consciously to reflect that within ourselves, to build a mental image of what is without, if reflected within, and we come to understand and know the reality itself. Now this empowers us to do things, as I mentioned earlier. Looking at the image to the left, this is an image from that's by Alex Gray, which is an artist, an amazing artist. He has a preponderance of symbolic works that discuss many of these things that we're talking about in allegorical and symbolic form. And what you can see here with this image is that you have a face of a man, and he's looking out, and there seems to be eyes everywhere, and he's looking out, but as you may have noticed already, it's almost like his head is creating like this bubble around him, and his perceived experience is coming through, or is being bounded by his mind. Okay, so I really like this image because basically it's symbolically representing the fact that all is mind. Everything we experience, everything that we come to know subjectively, is a reflection of our sense data within, how we choose to understand it. Okay, so even the words that I'm hearing, that you're hearing right now, okay, what's really happening is your ears are receiving the sound vibrations, the pressure waves, okay? And they're turning that into ones and zeros, which are going into your nervous system via the spinal cord. being then reflected again into nerve impulses and electrodynamic chemicals, okay, which are then getting accelerated towards the pineal gland, and that data is being transferred into the mental realm, where it is then reflected inside your mind, and then you choose to correspond and correlate this data, creating a reflection within, literally a hologram of reality, of the outer reality within yourself. And that's why I think this image is so poignant. Correspondence. Now, correspondence, this is another huge law. As I was mentioning earlier when we first started to go over these laws, it's almost difficult to try to just talk about one law all by itself. Because in order to really see it and understand it and how it works for us in the real world, in the physical world, everything works in harmony together. But this one is very, very important. As above, so below. As below, so above. So that's what correspondence is. It's what that is describing is a fractal. And we're going to get into that in a moment. It is represented by the third eye, or the third eye chakra. And it's self-reflected truth, perceiving reality as it is. So when I say self-reflected, I mean that it's self-reflected or self-actualized. It's recognized. It is acknowledged. So you could almost say that we're swimming in the truth. Reality, okay, the truth exists all around us. Okay, we move, breathe, and have our being in the truth. Okay, but the third eye, which is often associated with awakened consciousness or unity consciousness, is a product of self-reflection, meaning it's a creative act. It's a result of accumulated acts of choosing to understand and reflect reality within ourselves. As I mentioned in last week's show, this is positive knowledge here. So when you've accurately created a premise, when you have an idea, a proposition, okay, that is actually harmonizing with reality, for example, the world is round or the earth is round, that's that idea, that premise, it does actually reflect reality, okay? Well, now when you go and look outside, when you're in your experience, that's kind of like a screen. It literally allows you to perceive or allows you to see reality. There's a phrase that has been promulgated out through society. It's I believe the phrase is seeing is believing. Okay. Seeing is believing. Well, I think it's actually the reverse, isn't it? Believing is seeing. Because if you don't have knowledge, let's substitute the word belief with knowledge. Seeing is knowledge, or knowledge is seeing. Let's use that. Well, if you have knowledge, if you can accurately recognize the objects in your experience and represent them within your mind, you can see them for what they are. So just like we were talking about earlier with you coming into a room and you take a blindfold off and you start to become aware of the stuff that's in the room and you see that there's something on the coffee table. There's a glass of water on the coffee table. Well, if the knowledge that you have about water is accurate, then you can see it for what it is. Okay? And you can see that you can see that the water could be refreshing to you. It could be something that refreshes your thirst, or it could be something that allows you to clean your hands, or so it has uses. So my point here is that as you come to observe objects in reality, as you begin to reflect how they correspond with each other within your mental self, okay, your mind, then you literally get to see reality as it is. And that's why it's represented by the third eye, or awakened consciousness. So correspondence, again to emphasize the point, when we have two objects next to each other, okay, let's take the example. I don't know how many smokers we have here, but if you have a lighter, okay, and somebody puts a cigarette down on the table, there's a relationship between these two objects, isn't there? There's a potential created that you can become aware of. Because your mind allows you to represent things and relationships of objects as they correspond to each other. Okay, so you can see the fact that there's a lighter, you can see the fact that there's a cigarette, and you can do something with it. You could put the cigarette in your mouth, and you could light it, and you could smoke it if you want. Or you could say, I'm not a smoker, I don't want that, get that out of my face, and you could throw the cigarette away. But the point is that how objects correspond, what the relationship is between things, whether it's your judgment's calls, whether it's something in your perceived reality, whether it's a feeling, all of the things, everything, can correspond to something else. And this is really the correspondence between the outside reality and the inside reality, or your knowledge base. That's an aspect of correspondence. Fractality. So we're going to some different names for correspondence. Fractality, so fractals. If you look to the right, what you see is at the top image, you have the Mandelbrot set. Now, Mandelbrot set is Mandelbrot, I forget his first name, but he's a mathematician who successfully developed a mathematical formula which is expressed in iteration. So basically what you do is you take a formula and you keep repeating it over and over and over again. And as you repeat the formula over and over and over again, you get different iterations or expressions. Okay? And that's what that is. It's a fractal. Now, fractals are everywhere in our experience in reality. As I show you below here, you see you have the life symbol. So life is like an equation or a program. You could even say it's the DNA or whatnot, and it begins to express itself, begins to have iterations. So at first you have a seed, and then the seed comes up and something starts to grow, and then leaves start to come out, and then branches, okay, and it keeps unfolding the iteration. The formula keeps unfolding, just like the seashell here. Yet they snails and crustaceans, they grow calcium carbonate into their shells via a chemical process, and they do it in quantized chunks. They follow an iteration. That's why it has a certain pattern and a formula that you can see. Same thing with the sunflower and the rose and the, I believe that's a cactus right there. And then we have the galaxy, of course. So this is what a fractal is. When we're talking about fractals, we're talking about things that are self-similar, self-similarity. Now you can see this in your own human body. For example, if you take your hand, everybody can just pick up, look at your hand for a minute. Now, if you take your index finger and you bend it so it kind of makes a hook, if you look the distance between your knuckle, okay, or the part where your knuckle is the first bone off of your index finger, that has a certain length to it, okay? Now, if you compare that length to the next finger bone up, there's a proportion created there. The proportion is the golden mean ratio. And as you can notice, your hand itself, it's kind of like a branch, isn't it? Your arm comes down, which is like a trunk, and then it branches out into these things that are fingers, okay? And then when you follow that back up the chain, okay, your arm goes into this other trunk, which also has, oh, look at this, 5 branches, a head, 2 arms, and 2 legs. Okay, so we have the 5 fingers and we have the 5 appendages. All right, so this is what self-similarity is, and this is what fractality is, or a fractal is. Relativity, so the ability for things to have a relative relationship in a context. So for example, I was talking about a cigarette earlier. We could talk about, you're hungry and you want to make food and objects relative to each other. What are some other examples of things being relative to each other? Like in photography, for example, you have objects relative to each other. You have, when you take a photo of a certain scene or an image, there's objects in relation to each other, okay? Those objects are then reflected through the lens onto the photographic film or the digital plate, which then receives that data and creates a representation of it. Okay? Well, that image is similar to the scene. There's a reflection happening. There's a correspondence happening. Okay? And there's similarity between the two systems. You know, if you take the photo and then you take the actual scene and you hold the photo up right in front of where you took the scene, there's a fractal created right there. You have a smaller version of the scene right in your hands. Okay? And that's, of course, is reflectivity. So all of these terms kind of refer to the same thing. And as far as the total sense of unity of all things and no things. So when we talk about correspondence in a really grand, big sense, we're talking about the fact that everything corresponds to everything else. Everything is fractal with everything else. Everything relates to everything else. Everything is reflected in everything else, okay, in a certain context. Entrainment transfers data to corresponding things. Now, entrainment, this is a huge concept which we're going to get into later in this presentation, and especially when we talk about properties of mind, psiability, precognition, you know, many of the ascended abilities that we've talked about here. Really, the mechanism that allows these things to happen is entrainment. But even just in a more basic sense, when we talk about sharing of ideas, we're talking about entrainment. So, entrainment transfers data to corresponding things. I don't have the image of the metronomes, but I've used this image in the past to describe this idea of entrainment, and it's an amazing example, so I'll just briefly describe it to you here. If you want to see a video of this, just do a Google search for metronomes synchronizing or metronome synchronization. There's several YouTube videos to look at. And when you click on one, you're going to see, let me describe the scene to you here. I want you to imagine that you've got a table in front of you. And on the table, there's this tray, kind of like a dinner tray. And on the dinner tray, there's four metronomes. Now, for those of you who don't know, a metronome is the thing that ticks back and forth in music to describe a beat or a certain tempo or rhythm. Okay? So it goes click, 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 click. So if you can imagine these four metronomes. Now, let's imagine that each metronome is set to move at a different rhythm. So you may have one at 60 beats per minute, you may have one at 80 beats per minute, you may have one at 120 beats per minute, and you may have one at 200 beats per minute. Okay? And then in front of the dinner tray, there's these two cans of any, really you could say it's a rolling pin, as long as there are two things that roll. So what happens is, right as you imagine this, the metronomes are all ticking away, tick, 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 but they're not in harmony with each other. They're just kind of ticking. Okay? And then is when you take the tray and you lift it up and you place it on the tin can, something interesting happens. The motion of the individual metronome starts to cause the tray to sway back and forth on the cans. And what's happening here is that the metronome's movement, each individual metronome's movement, one's moving at 60, one's moving at 80, one's moving at 120, one's moving at 200, okay? Now their motion is allowed to come into contact with each other. They can actually start to communicate. And what happens over the course of about 10 or 15 seconds is the motion is allowed to entrain, okay? And whatever dominant frequency there is that is acting on the whole system begins to represent itself. So basically what you'll observe is that over about 15 seconds, the metronomes, they find a new beat, and they all start to beat in harmony with each other. So let's imagine that they all start to beat at 110 beats a second, or 110 beats a minute, okay? And they're literally swaying back and forth. So now we have this dinner tray, or this tray, it's sitting on the two cans, kind of rocking back and forth, and all the metronomes are rocking in harmony with each other, in unison with each other. Now, this is called entrainment, and basically what we're talking about here is the ability of things that correspond with each other, as long as the things are allowed to be communicated, allowed to be observed and share concepts and ideas, information will transfer. Okay, and this is exactly what communication is. And we're going to be getting into this in a little bit. Intelligence is created by choosing. I'm going to fix my slide here, I apologize. Intelligence is created by choosing to reflect within what is without. Positive knowledge. It is relative to our awareness, the objects in our perception, as we choose to give them meaning. So, basically what we're talking about here is that intelligence is a manifestation of, well, all of the principles in reality, but in relation to correspondence, intelligence is the ability to take two objects, put them into some context, or allow them to you to become aware of them, okay, and then decipher whatever their relationship is, and accurately decipher that and reflect it within yourself. And it is relative to our awareness and our perception. So if we misperceive an object, we're not going to be able to reflect it properly within ourselves. Now, some examples of systems that work this way. I mean, we could pretty much choose anything, but I wanted to pick examples that really hit the point. Our immune system. Our immune system is a wonderful example of correspondence and fractality. So, for example, when you go to eat food, okay, when you actually go to put the food in your mouth, even before you put the food in your mouth, when you're smelling the food, your body is taking all these little pieces of the material. That's what smell is. Okay, there's little particles of the eggs that you cooked or the salad that you made, and they're floating in the air, and your body has a sense node to actually find that little particle and have it match with something. Okay, so you become aware of this thing. And now what happens is your body actually begins to create all of the digestive juices and prepare your digestive system for whatever it is you're about to eat. Now when you actually put the food in your mouth, the glands underneath your tongue, your tonsils, and there's a whole host of glands inside your body all the way down into your stomach, okay, and they don't stop in your stomach, they keep going. But basically, there's a whole bunch of sensory nodes, and what's happening is as soon as you place food in your stomach or in your mouth, whatever that food is made of, there's a response or a reflection of that by way of whatever the digestive juices or things that are being created in your body. Same thing when we talk about immunization or building up an immune system. I don't want to use the example of vaccines because there's so much controversy about that, but doing some really old ideas of immunization, many merchants back in the day, especially in Persian culture, and I discovered this through researching urine therapy, the merchants, when they would go to a new town or a village, they would look for the strongest man, and they'd ask, or a woman, and they'd ask for a small sample of their urine. And they'd take a little bit of the urine and they'd put it underneath their tongue, okay? And what's happening there is that whatever contagions, whatever molds and things that are in the environment, okay, that require an antibody or some type of a mechanism to make sure that they don't override the body, well, that person is going to already have them. And what happens is when you take the urine, they're inside, those antibodies are actually in the urine because urine is just your blood distillation. Okay, the beneficial compounds that your body uses to maintain its cells that are released inside the urine. Okay, so when you take a little drop of that and you put it in your mouth, especially the merchants, what they were doing is their immune system would recognize what those antibodies were, and it literally would encode those antibodies in the immune system. So now it would be able to reflect what it needs to reflect, or create a fractal representation, an image, of the outward reality, whatever the contagion, whatever the mold is, inside themselves, immunizing them. Perception, as we mentioned earlier, is the same thing. When you acknowledge, seeing is knowledge, instead of seeing is believing. Okay? So whatever knowledge you have acquired, whatever meaning you give the symbols, if you've never learned English, and you're looking at English, you're not going to know what it means. You can't even perceive what the ideas are that are expressed in the words. But if you do, then you can perceive them. So it's a process of reflectivity or fractality, of correspondence. Intuition is the same thing. intuition is a product of having a mental image or putting your attention or focus on something that creates a scene within your mind that corresponds to something that's actually out there in reality. And by way of entrainment, there is data and information that's allowed to flow in. I won't get too much into the science of that right now, but we do intend on doing a whole show about those types of things. And the modality of it is entrainment and correspondence. Love and consciousness. This is also about correspondence. Love, there's been described in many works that there's really only two emotions. There's love and there's fear. When you're in a state of love, when you're in the heart space, to use a popular term right now, you're open. You're open-minded. You're receiving. You're accepting. You're willing. Okay? And it creates an openness, a flow. You're allowed to receive the information within yourself, make sense of it, become aware of it, have a consciousness of it, okay, and then give it meaning so that you can reflect it in reality. You can be aware of how it corresponds, okay, and all these things are fractal. Vibration. Nothing rests, everything moves, everything vibrates. So, obviously, I think this is obvious, the chakra that corresponds with this is the throat chakra, your voice, the thing that allows you to speak, okay? And it's about communication, all right? Now, vibration is the aspect of motion, basically. Now, when we're going to be talking about vibration, it's kind of difficult to talk about just vibration, as I was mentioning, so I'm probably going to be using other ideas that could be lumped into the other principles, but we're talking about oscillation here, or movement. And now, vibration is in physical science, we know this as oscillation, okay, so when things oscillate, and they are described in terms of waves, wave properties. So there's several properties of waves that allow us to come to understand what waves are, and they have frequency, so how often they happen. They have a period, so however long it takes for that thing to have a certain amount of frequency. Okay, we have a wavelength, so what is the distance or the amount of polarization between the two waves, okay? And an amplitude, how strong the waves are. And this is all the science of oscillation. So really, when we think of vibration, we're talking about waveforms. Okay, and this has been termed harmonics, or the harmonic universe. Okay, harmonization, harmonizing. In many New Age concepts and the awakening community, there's this idea of vibration, frequency. You have to raise your vibration. Things like this, okay? Well, this is what we're talking about here. We're talking about waves and frequency. And I didn't put this slide in here, but one of the amazing slides about awareness is, okay, the greater your awareness, the greater your ability to have accurate knowledge, the higher your vibration, okay? It increases your ability to be aware of more things because, for example, you know, if looking at the image to the left, we see that there's waveforms, okay? Well, I want you to imagine that above that dotted line, looking up at the top left, every time the wave goes above the line, your consciousness is looking at something. Your attention is on something. And when it goes below, it's not. It's on something else. Or maybe it's not active at all. You're in daydream. So if you have a high frequency or a high vibration, there's going to be more times where that wave touches or goes above the line. Okay? And this is directly a result of how much knowledge you've attained. Remember, seeing is knowledge, or whatever you perception is a product of knowledge. How you accurately you can perceive and define your reality is going to dictate how much of your reality you can actually receive, which is going to, obviously, if you know nothing and you walk into a room, you can't make sense of anything. So there's really no meaning about anything that you can perceive, and you could say that you're, as far as your awareness is concerned, you're in a low vibration because you're really not aware of anything. But as you come to know and understand your reality, you become more aware, you're able to recognize more objects in your reality, which allows you to see how these objects correspond, building knowledge, which allows you to perceive and become aware of more things, so your awareness is expanded, and you have a higher vibration now. Okay? Getting into entrainment again, all things can entrain, share motion, and information with similar systems. Mental images can be communicated to others. So basically, when we talk about expression, verbalizing ideas, what I'm doing right now, I'm speaking, I'm using my throat to communicate. I'm creating sound symbols. You know, words are sound symbols. They're neutral in meaning. You know, I'm speaking English right now, and if somebody who's never heard English in their life hears my words, they're not going to be able to get anything out of them as far as the meaning of the idea is concerned. Okay? Because, why? Because they don't have the knowledge within them. But when they do have the knowledge, so they do speak English, okay, and I speak English, well, now there's a similarity, there's a correspondence, there's a fractality or fractal of English between in one person's mind and English in another person's mind. And now we can use vibrations, just like the metronomes, to communicate ideas, mental images between the two systems. Some examples of vibration is light, sound, consciousness, heat, electromagnetism, and life. All are governed by the properties of waves. So the things I mentioned earlier, frequency, period, wavelength, amplitude, are all properties of waves, which are actually all part of the seven principles as well. You know, wavelength refers, or period refers to rhythm, amplitude refers to polarity, wavelength refers to vibration. So looking at the image to the left, I chose this image because it kind of emphasizes the whole negative and positive knowledge thing. When you have constructive interference, when one wave matches the other wave and they're in phase with each other, they're in lock, or one wave accurately reflects the other, what happens when you add the two together? Well, you get an increased amplification. You're at a higher vibration, so to speak. And there's more energy there, okay? In the reverse situation, when you take a wave that is out of phase, okay, so the waves don't match up, when you go to add them together, they cancel each other out. So if I'm speaking English and somebody's speaking, or somebody doesn't know English and they only know Japanese, well, when I speak, it's like nothing happens. That the data gets canceled out because the systems don't match. Okay? And this, again, this emphasizes, this is kind of like an allegory for positive and negative knowledge, or having real intrinsic knowledge. Moving on to polarity. Everything is dual, has its poles, its opposites. Degrees of unity. Okay, so basically what we're talking about here is the ability to perceive opposites. And one thing that we'll get into here is that there are degrees of unity, meaning that in reality we're talking about the same unified system of things, okay? But because of our point of view, we see them as opposites. Now, heart chakra, this is the center chakra. This is the midpoint between the lower chakras and the above chakras. And as such, polarity is the midpoint between the seven principles. And when we are open with love to understanding that what the relationship of dualism really is, or polarity, we have a union happening of dualism. Okay, so the things that were once perceived as dual, meaning completely opposite of each other and not having any relation, like bad and good, you know, oh, bad. Well, bad things don't have anything to do with good things. Well, that's not really the case. They're actually one and the same. It's just your point of view may be different. Okay? So dualism is perceived as a point of view. So that's as such as polarity. Opposites are identical in nature, but different in degree. So, some examples of this. We have cold and hot. Well, something that's cold for us, all right, like ice, okay, It has less heat than something that is hot, like steam. Okay, well, they're both things are made of water. So what are we really talking about here? What's the difference? We're talking about heat, okay? And heat is motion, of course, but more to the point is that, you know, I may experience something as cold. For example, right now it's about 50 degrees outside. To me, that's cold. But to somebody who's been living in Alaska their whole life, like an Inuit Indian, they're acclimatized to the cold. They may think that's hot. The point is that depending on your point of view, you're going to have a spectrum on the right and a spectrum on the left. You're going to have something below and something above your point of view, okay? Light and dark are another example of this. Small and big. Falsehood and truth. I'm going to get to this one in a moment here. Unconsciousness and consciousness. Okay, these are all polarities. These are all degrees of the same thing, just a different orientation, an expression expressed differently depending on the context. Fear and love, same thing. Degrees of unity experienced as dual depending on the context. So your ability to be conscious, for example, well, we may say we're unconscious, like we're daydreaming. You know, oh, he's unconscious right now. He's not aware. Well, yes, you're not aware of what may be happening physically in the room, but you're doing something else, aren't you? You're daydreaming. You're aware of something else. So it's a context. It's a degree. When you're asleep, you may be at a lower level of consciousness. You're not conscious of the physical things around you, but you're conscious of something else. You're conscious of your dream world, okay? Fear and love. In this relationship, we're talking about fear in the more, I guess you could say, scientific definition. What is fear? Fear is the rejection of data, the closing or segregation of things. So with fear, it's almost like you're trying to say, no, I don't want this. Okay, with love, you're saying, yes, I want this. I accept this, okay? So what is the thing that unifies it to? It is you. You're the thing that it unifies it to. And your choice, whether or not to receive or deny it, is the thing that builds the context or the polarity. Now, this is the big one that I almost was hesitant in putting this in the slide because it can be really misunderstood. But as far as truth and falsehood, so all truths, okay, are half-truths, part of the truth, negative and positive knowledge. Hence, discussion purifies our knowledge base. So, basically what we're talking about is that as you come to understand a truth, like the world is round, okay, that truth is like a quantized chunk. Yes, it is. It does have applicability. You can fill it up and have a complete knowledge of the context of the fact that the world is round, okay? But that's not going to describe the whole truth, okay? And it's a spectrum, so as you come to understand a chunk of truth, you build a piece of positive knowledge within yourself. Well now, after you've gone through that contemplation process, which is kind of like a compression, you're going to start to see it in your reality, you're going to start to perceive it in your reality. And that's going to cause an expansion. Now that truth is going to get interlinked or correspond with other truths. And that correspondence, it naturally creates an expansion process. So it is a polarity, it is a spectrum. The acquisition of truth, the ability to know the truth and perceive it and ground it into yourself for us is a constant process. So we're always accumulating more and more and more. We're always, ideally, we're going from the pole of, fear, or the pole of unconsciousness to consciousness by attaining knowledge. And I put hence discussion purifies our knowledge base because when we come to know a truth, when we come to know knowledge, it needs to be tested, it needs to be lived in order for it to really have an impact on us. And when we speak it into our existence, especially with other beings, we get to hear their point of view. We get to hear how they understand the truth. And if we do it in an open way and we're really willing to hear their idea completely and without bias, then we can dissect that idea on our own and come to understand it ourselves. And that may, if the idea is valid, if it has actually represents reality, it's going to help us purify our knowledge base. Rhythm. Everything cycles in and out, up and down. Okay? And this is the solar plexus chakra, the self related to the world. So the solar plexus, this is kind of like our emotional center. As Marx says, you kind of have your heart, then you got your mind, and then you got your guts, your actions. So your heart, you're in love. Your mind, that's when you're discerning, you're processing, and then you got to do something with it. You got to act, okay? So the self related to the world, this is how you relate to the world and how, what is the ramifications of your actions? Okay, this is why it's the emotional center. So your emotions, it's kind of like your emotions are really like the way that you detect the results of your actions. It's kind of like your karma detection. You know, when you're experiencing something in your reality that creates a negative emotion, like burning your hand, okay? It's because there was an action that you took. You did something. You generated something. Now, what was the result? Is that result, it can teach you something. And, for example, in relation to burning your hand, you may have a negative emotional reaction. You may say, oh, I don't want to do that. Or, that hurts, or etc. Well, within that reaction is the keys to understanding how to better create, okay? So, as far as cycles are concerned, we have tides. There are some examples. We have day and night, the seasons, our moods. Consciousness has cycles, unconsciousness, subconsciousness, being awake, being asleep, being in imagination, being focused on something. Okay, so we've got different degrees of cycles there. Another example is happiness follows sadness. So, usually if we're sad, eventually something's going to change. We may start to feel happy again, and then something may change, and we may start to feel sad again, and then something may change, and we may start to feel happy again, okay? So our emotions tend to cycle. Really, everything tends to cycle. Excitement follows boredom. So this, I feel like this is a really good example, you know, when you're, and you can see this a lot in movies. They call this the wow factor. So when a movie first comes out, it's a completely new type of a movie, like Star Wars, for example. You know, when Star Wars first came out, nobody really had any awareness. It was a very novel and new idea. And it was very exciting. It's like, oh, wow, this is amazing. You know, I've never seen this before. But then 20, 30 years later, we've got TV shows, action figures, we've got, you know, six movies. Well, now the wow factor is kind of gone. Everybody knows about, you know, the Force and the Empire and the Rebellion and, you know, all these things. So now, you need to do something new or more novel in order to not have it be boring. Excuse me. So, the point here is that as we become familiar with things, as we live our experiences, they come in cycles, okay? Another really good example that I haven't listed here is eating food. I know, food can be a really, it's almost like a talisman or something that we do that allows us to feel or experience something in consciousness. So, you know, you've heard of people who eat to comfort themselves. And I'll freely admit that when I'm not feeling good, there's nothing like having a good piece of food to make you feel better. Well, it's transient, isn't it? Or it's not lasting. So you may not feel so great. And then you eat the food and you feel good, and while you're eating the food, it may feel good, but as soon as you stop eating the food, you know, you kind of start to go back down to wherever you were feeling before, unless you do some new creative act to change your experience. And now, as far as truth and acquiring knowledge and truths are offered by experience, so we are living our experience, which is the creating the potential for truth as we become aware of things. They're tested and understood, and they expand our perception. So basically, new data is received by way of expanding the perception, because once we have a truth, for example, we acknowledge the fact that the frying pan is hot on the stove, okay? It changes our perception, doesn't it? So when we burn our hand, this is new data. Okay, and this new data allows us to go and understand, build our knowledge base, which then changes our perception again. So it's a cycle. Okay, acquiring truth is definitely a cycle. And then I've listed these two items here, contemplation, compression, and recognition, expansion. So I would argue that when we were really in that mode of acquiring knowledge and truth, you know, we're in our experience, we're doing our thing, we're in the kitchen, we're making our dinner, and then we think we got the truth, and we go to grab that stove, that hot frying pan, and we get burned. Well, hold on a second. Whoa, now we got to have a compression. We got to contemplate what just happened. So we kind of take a step back. And, you know, I do this sometimes where I'm not moving my body, but I'm kind of like in my mind. So you could say it's like a compression. You pulled your awareness into yourself. And now you're in the mental realm. Okay, you're in the causal plane, which we'll get into in a moment, where you're really thinking about, well, wait a minute, what happened? What did I miss? How did I misidentify or not recognize this object in my reality properly? Let me contemplate that and come to a better understanding so I can then go outside of myself and recognize that. Okay, so it's a compression and expansion. This is a rhythm. It's a cycle. And, of course, we have the, I used as an example of this for this image, the cycle of water. So we got water. It evaporates from the sun. You know, if you're near a lake or the grass, any plants, the process of photosynthesis creates oxygen and H2O, which is released into the atmosphere, which goes up into the upper atmosphere, which is cooler than the lower surface, condensing on cloud, small particles, cloud condensation nuclei, which then form clouds, which then go into colder and lower pressure systems, which then rain down on the ground, which then go back into the earth, and the cycle repeats and repeats and repeats. So one example of cycle, or rhythm. Causality. This is a huge one. Causality, cause and effect. All motions, things, are a result of a cause. Sacral chakra, the ego experience. So, when you're excited, just to speak about the solar plexus and the sacral chakra, when you're excited and you're happy and you're acting and you're doing something, and you have a lot of energy, you're in the solar plexus. For me, I literally feel this feeling in my solar plexus, okay? Now, if I'm feeling anxious or if I maybe have this moment where I, like, I have to do a reality check, and let's say, for example, I get a letter in the mail that says, you know, I owe all this money. And I'm like, oh Jesus, what? So I'm kind of like reassessing myself. I'm redefining myself. You know, we got into this in the last episode, episode 2, really heavily, where the ego is created as a result of our knowledge base, our self-knowledge, okay? So when your knowledge of self may be being called into question, like, let's say you're about to go out on a date and you're not sure that if you're confident about how good you look or whether or not they're going to like you or anything like that, you may get butterflies in your stomach, right? Well, for me, that's what I experience. I feel, you know, if I'm having this really like, oh my God, I need to look at what's happening. I got to redefine myself experience. Usually I kind of feel it in my sacral chakra. So what I'm getting at here is causality, or what we cause, what we think we can do, what the things that we can put into effect, okay, is an ego experience. It relates to the ego, our identification of self, which is the sacral chakra. Now, in understanding the two planes, we have the causal plane of intentions and the effect plane of manifestation. This is huge. Basically, anything in our reality that we're trying to manifest. So let's say we want to be thin, and we feel like we need to lose some weight. Okay, well, what do you got to do? You got to think about your ideas. You got to change your habits and your agenda and your processes. These are the causes. This is in the mental plane, right? Now, if you're trying to lose weight by changing the effects, you know, maybe instead of eating a loaf of bread, you decide to eat a huge bowl of cereal, well, you're just switching one effect for another. You're not really addressing the true cause. A better example would be if you misidentify something, because that's in the causal plane, in the mental plane, if you the knowledge that you have in relation to the object in reality is not accurate, when you go to act on it, what happens? You get an effect that you didn't anticipate. So the manifested results based on your intentions isn't what you desired. Okay? So this is cause and effect. This is the law of karma. And this works not only just in the mental plane, but in the physical. So to bring this into the mental plane, we have the idea of imagination. What do we think about? What do you put your focus on? Well, if I tell you to imagine, like earlier I was talking about imagining the metronome. So I want you to imagine a metronome. I want you to imagine a pizza. I want you to imagine a basketball. Imagine that you're on a sandy beach. Well, for most of us, even myself, as I say the words, what happens is immediately there's an image that comes to mind. So what's happening here? There's a cause, okay, that I'm making, and then the effect is in my imagination. That's in the mental plane. In the physical plane, we have cause and effect all the time. You know, if you want to take a glass of water, you got to initiate a cause. You got to put the water and you got to tip it up over your mouth. And what is the effect? It starts to pour into your mouth and down your throat so you can drink it. So there's a causal chain of events. Every idea, emotion, and object is an effect of a cause. So basically, everything that we come to experience has its cause. It is an effect of a cause. And as well, because of correspondence, it is also the cause of some future effect. So there's reflectivity, there's a corresponding relationship between all things, depending on the context that you talk about, especially in relation to cause and effect. This has been called karmic law, the law of attractiveness. Okay? Or, I'm sorry, the law of attraction. Now, this little blurb here, I basically am talking about how we can use karma to benefit us in our lives. The effectiveness of our actions, wanted or unwanted, results from how well we recognize what is our knowledge base. Unwanted effects, karma, is data which can be used to purify our knowledge. So just like using the example I've been using about burning your hand, you go to burn your hand, all you really wanted to do was just flip the pancakes or, you know, move the stir fry that you were cooking. And what you got was a burnt hand. So the result of our actions, the effectiveness of our actions, is directly reflected on how well, or directly course results from how well we recognize these objects in reality. And recognition is directly related to our knowledge. Did we have knowledge that the frying pan was hot? Well, maybe we did and we chose not to acknowledge it. Maybe we were in ignorance, or maybe we just didn't correctly perceive it and we didn't identify it and come to understand it in our reality, in our experience. So unwanted effects, which has been termed karma, so basically when you have something happen to you that you say, I don't want that, I don't want to get burned, okay, that's an experience. It's data. It's something that we can use to actually help us. We can say, oh, you mean when this pan is hot on the stove, if I put my hand on it, I'm going to get burnt, and I don't want that experience? Well, now we can recognize that, okay? We can acknowledge it, and now we can allow it to be received in our knowledge base. And now, when we go to grab the pan again, maybe we can grab an oven mitt this time. Now, I used an image of a man skipping stones on a beach to kind of emphasize the fact that the causality is something that is ever rippling. So we have things that have been set into motion, and those things that have set into motion, it's like a constant unfoldment, a constant chain. There's no mutual exclusivity here. You can't pick one thing out of the sea or the ocean of effect, cause and effect, and say, well, this is just self-contained. No, everything you look at is the generated effect of a cause and is also in the process or could potentially cause the process of affecting something else. Gender. Okay, now this is probably one of those misunderstood principles of natural law, I would say. When we talk about gender, we're not talking about sexuality or sexual organs, although that is a manifestation of gender. So what we're talking about is generation. How do things get created? How do we have cause and effect, essentially? And what we're doing is we have the masculine and the feminine principle. So again, I'm not talking about masculine as in sexual organs. I'm not talking about feminine as in sexual organs. Although we can understand these concepts using those physical objects and those analogies. What we're talking about is principles. Now this relates to the root chakra. The root chakra is binary, meaning it's either on or off. It's either active or it's not. Okay? Now, within the mental plane, so we're going to look at a context to try to understand this, the subconscious is feminine. The conscious is masculine. Now, briefly, I just want to talk about the colors that I used here. The reason why gender is the color green is because it's the unification of the masculine and the feminine principles. That's why green is everywhere in nature. Okay? It's because it's a product, it's a created thing, a generated thing. It's a union of the two. You know? Now, the subconscious is blue. The color blue, in actual, when you see the color blue, what it has a tendency to do to your mind is allow you to start opening up and receiving your mind. It literally puts you into a theta state. So you just start receiving data subconsciously, okay? The sky is also blue, isn't it? Okay? Now we have, I chose the color red because it's an active color. Now the sun isn't red, but you could extrapolate that the sun is an active principle, okay? So when we have the generation of life, we have the earth, okay, which the sky is blue. I'm speaking allegorically here, so don't take what I'm saying literally. And you have the sun coming together to form a union or to generate something, which is life, which is green, okay? Now the color red also is a color that usually invokes an action, so it brings something to your attention. That's why stop signs are red. That's why things in advertising and most symbols in our society, when they're trying to get you to do something, it's a red thing. When they're trying to get you to yield or just accept, it's blue. Now, getting into the paragraph here, not talking about the colors anymore. Within our minds, within the mental plane, we have the subconscious, the feminine, and the conscious, masculine. The masculine can focus attention, but not create. The feminine contains all potentials, but needs an action to generate a result, imagination. So just like I was talking about earlier, when I say the word basketball, it's your masculine aspect of your mind, your focus, it immediately goes to the things in your experience and your knowledge base that relate to that verbal symbol of a basketball. And what happens in your subconscious, where all the accumulated data is just kind of hanging out, it immediately bubbles up to the surface, and you get an image of a basketball coming into your imagination. Okay? So within the mental plane, the process of gender, I mean, we could probably do a series of shows on understanding these principles. Briefly, I'll just mention that in relation to discernment, if you're not consciously trying to focus your attention on something, a premise more specifically, if you're not looking at somebody's ideas that where they say, oh, well, you know, it's cloudy outside, and you don't consciously think about that and say, oh, it's cloudy outside? Then you just accept that into your subconscious. You just accept that into yourself because you don't have an active male principle. Okay, and this is the basis for mind control. So really, getting to the example of the cook I mentioned earlier, if you're following a recipe, your masculine aspect, you really just focused on the recipe, but more to the point, you're not generating your own knowledge because you're just following the recipe of somebody else. And that person's masculine aspect is directing your knowledge of how to follow the recipe, which is the knowledge you have inside of you, about how to chop the vegetables, how to cook the onions or whatever it is you're doing. Okay, and now their will is directing your feminine aspect. Moving on to the next bullet point, free will focuses onto things, generating meanings from the subconscious, our knowledge base. So it's almost like when I kind of had this thought experiment a few months ago, where if you can think about your mind and how it works, it's like you're sitting in a wading pool, okay? And the surface of the pool is right up to your belly button, so to speak. And floating on the pool are these lily pads. And on the lily pads, imagine that there's words, okay? And each word represents an idea. So on one lily pad, you have the idea of, I'll just use the example before, a basketball. Or maybe you have the idea of roundness. Or maybe you have the idea of light, or so basically any idea you put on the lily pad. So what happens when you go to grab the idea is you're putting your focus on it. And when you pull it up, you pull the lily pad up, you notice that the roots of the lily pad are attached to all these other things. And not only do you get the idea of a basketball, but it's attached to the idea of roundness, and it starts to pull up, and it's attached to the idea of light, and it's attached to the idea of texture and the color orange and the game of basketball, and maybe watching basketball with your family back in the day, and, you know, all this other stuff. So what I'm getting at here is that when we use our masculine aspect to analyze ideas and put our focus on them, the interconnectedness of everything begins to present itself, and we can start to pull on these threads and pull up ideas and see how they all correspond to each other. An example of gender is chemistry. Vinegar has the potential to react. So the vinegar is just sitting there. If you do nothing to the vinegar, there's going to be no reaction, no generated result. But if you add a catalyst, in this case baking soda, what's going to happen? You're going to get a reaction. There's going to be something that's generated, okay? So in terms of the masculine and feminine principles, okay, we have the vinegar. You could even say the baking soda, those two objects by themselves are in potential, okay? They're like the feminine aspect. But then when you act, okay, this is why I chose this example, because you have to do something, you have to direct yourself into action with your will, then you literally take these two things and you put them together, and what happens? You get a result. Now, the other thing that I wanted to mention is the similarity between the word will, which has become to be known as free will, you know, free will, our ability to choose. It's also a name, isn't it? A masculine name. Isn't that interesting? And for anybody who's watched Star Trek before, Julian and I, we watch Star Trek quite a bit, and I love the show. And in Star Trek Next Generation, they've got an allegory of what I'm talking about, don't they?
The mind, yeah.
Right. So, like, on the bridge of the Enterprise, Next Generation, you got Captain Picard. He's sitting in between Will Riker and Deanna Troi. Mm-hmm. Now, Will, if you just do a Google search for the Will Riker, Captain Picard, and Deanna Troi on the bridge, you'll probably see an image of them sitting. And that image is basically an allegorical representation of what I'm talking about here. Okay, so within our brain, we have the left brain and the right brain. The left brain is associated with the masculine aspect, discernment. The right brain is associated with creation and receiving data. Okay, so it's a passive versus active.
And the captain is the wisdom.
Right. The union of the two.
That's
good. So on Captain Picard's right-hand side, all right, you have Will. Okay, and on his left-hand side, you have Deanna. So, first of all, his name is Will, okay? So, free will, the masculine aspect. Right there, for me, it's like glaringly obvious. This is what the allegory is. Now, you may be thinking to yourself, well, if he's on the right, that doesn't correspond with the brain, right? Well, no, actually it does, because in our bodies, even though our right hand our right hand is governed by the left brain, and our left hand is governed by the right brain, because our bodies are split into two halves. So the left side of the body is governed by the right brain, and the right side of the body is governed by the left brain. So, in reality, in the allegory of the show, okay, Troy, who is the feminine, Diana is a name coming back from the goddess of Diana, which is the feminine goddess, the feminine principle, okay? And in the show, she's half telepathic. She's empathic. She can detect people's emotions and intuitions, okay? And she's on the left-hand side, which corresponds to the right brain, okay? Because they're switched. So looking at this allegory, this is a perfect reflection or allegory for the principle of gender. And then when you actually watch the show, what happens? You have the captain, he issues orders. When the shields need to go up, who does he tell to put up the shields? Riker, right? He says, Will, raise the shields, or Will, do this, or Will, do that.
His commander.
His commander, exactly. The person who takes action. And then we have Deanna on the left-hand side, okay, for the right brain. When he's speaking with somebody and he's not sure what their intentions are, and he needs to get a feeling, he needs to get an intuition for what's happening, he asks Deanna, what's happening? What are you sensing, Deanna? Okay? And so literally, in the show, you have a perfect allegory for what this principle of gender is.
Trinity.
Exactly, the Trinity. And on the left-hand side, I wasn't making a joke with this image, but basically what I'm showing here is this is what happens when you put Mentos into Diet Coke or Coca-Cola. When you put Mentos in, if the soda's just sitting there, okay, it has the potential, but it has potential for many things, okay? All potentials, remember? This is what the feminine does. Just like in the brain as well. I didn't get into this earlier, but Mark Passio gets into this extensively in his presentation. Your limbic brain, your emotional brain, that's where the subconscious receives everything. And your reptilian brain, or the masculine brain, is where it's on or off, it's binary. You're either in fight or flight or you're not, okay? But anyway, in relation to this image on the left, the soda is just sitting there. It has the potential to do something. And when you put the Mentos in, what happens? You get a massive fountain of soda that spews all over the place. And, I mean, if you've ever seen this happen before, if you haven't seen this happen before, I strongly suggest doing a Google search. You see how cool it is. It's actually pretty neat. But basically, you get this huge reaction. So this is a generated result. Okay, our last slide for this week's show. Now, basically, what I wanted to do is I kind of wanted to go through an example of or a chain of events of how all of the principles work together in our everyday life. So I did this in kind of a story format, a loose story format. Objects observed by the senses are reflected in the mind via imagination. I chose the colors here for a specific reason. So basically what I'm doing is we're starting in mentalism and we're working our way down to gender, and we're using colors to refer to what process or what context we can use to understand what's happening. So the color blue here, we're in the mental field. Objects observed by the senses are reflected in the mind via imagination. So the reflected is in green because it's a creative act. So it's a gender. It requires the will and the conscious mind and the subconscious to actually properly understand and discern what's happening in the mind and then reflecting it via imagination. Now this charges the desire for moving the will into action. Okay? So just like I've been saying in these examples, when you see objects in your awareness, that naturally charges the desire to want to do something with them. You know, if you see somebody's got there's a fire starting in the corner of your living room, you're aware of these objects, you may even be aware that there's a big bucket of water sitting right there, so it's probably going to give you the desire to want to put the fire out, okay? Now this is in yellow because the objects correspond with each other. As you become aware of the relationship between objects and how they relate, okay, there's a potential to direct the will into action. Action is in blue because it's a cause and effect type of a relationship. this generates or this creates a vibration, okay? So again, all things are vibration. Now, a vibration is a correspondence of moving objects in a polarized way, all right? So all things are moving, and depending on what your context is, you're going to see a certain manifested pole. Okay, so for example, the fire in the living room, that's going to be hot to you. That's one end of the polarity. Okay? And way, of course, is in yellow because it's a correspondence. Now, we're getting, the rest is in blue for the most part because we're getting into the karmic aspect. What is the effectiveness of things? How does this relate to the cause and effect, the causal realm? The effectiveness of the cause to generate the imagined result depends on how accurately the objects observed correspond to their images reflected within the mind. So basically, the effectiveness of the cause, we're talking about karma. What was the actual real result based on our actions? Not what we wanted to think we had happen, okay, because that's what we're talking about with karma. We're talking about what actually happened, the effectiveness of our cause. To generate the imagined results. So the imagined result is our desire, our intention. So we have the juxtaposition between the two. There's a tension differential between what we imagine and what was actually happened, okay, the result. This depends on how accurately, which is in yellow because it corresponds, okay, the correspondence of things, the relationship of things, how accurately these objects observed correspond to their images, the things in our mind, reflected within the mind. So how did we decide to create the mental scape of our experience? This is how natural law lives out in our lives. Okay? Every moment of every day, we're observing things, we come to know and become aware of things mentally, we observe the relationship, okay, that they have. This creates a natural charge or vibration, our desire to want to create something in a polarized way, which is also rhythmic, and is going to relate causally, or the cause and effect, to how well we imagined it. That's what the generation principle, or the generation of our imagined desire is in relation to a thing. All right, well, this is the end of section 3. Again, you can check the description. I'm going to go ahead and include the link to the blog where you can see these images. And I apologize for the misspellings in my images before. I will go ahead and update those in the blog post so you can see the corrected version. The show that normally has, we're normally playing the show, sorry, with Sierra Blina on Galactic U Radio Network, which you can also find inside the description of this YouTube video. And that show is presently playing, depending on when you're listening to this video. It is presently playing or live on Sunday, 6 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. So you can catch the new episodes there. We'll be continuing on with our presentation here on truth and natural law, and how it affects our reality, and getting into some really amazing, empowering concepts in the future. If you have questions for myself or Julian, suggestions, discussion points, would love to get participation and really have an actual discussion, not so much of a monologue. That would be really something I would like to do. You can send an email to sitsshow@gmail.com. You can send an email to us there. Our blog is sitsshow.blogspot.com. You can find us on the blog there. And we look forward to doing next week's show. Until next time.
Until next time.